Today I'm going to speak about subjective refraction. This is what we do every day in trial. Whenever you have a reading with retinoscopy or autoref, you start to apply lenses to recheck the values and make sure that you are going to give a patient a proper prescription. First, you need to proper centralize the trial frame in front of the patient's eye. Also, should avoid any pantoscopic tilt of the trial frame, and also keep an eye on the vertex distance, the distance between the lenses and the cornea. This is especially important in high errors. We used to examine one eye at a time, so we accustomed to occlude the other eye. Occlusion can be done by one of two things, either by opaque occluder or better by using a plus occluder. We put plus lenses in front of the eyes of increasing power till the visual acuity drops by two lines. If the visual acuity does not drop, we can add more plus lenses. In this situation, when the visual acuity is dropped by two lines, then we are sure that the patient is not accommodating. The problem with the occluder that this can be stimulus for accommodation, so it's better to go for the plus occluder. Now we can start doing the trial on the second eye. We start by the reading we have from retinoscopy or the autoref. Our goal is to correct the patient while accommodation is fully relaxed. And also, we need this accommodation fully relaxed in both eyes. Why we need full relaxed accommodation? So the patient can have whole range of accommodation available to use when looking at near objects, and also to avoid asinopia if there is ciliary body overaction. We need it to be equally relaxed in both eyes, and this is known as binocular balance. We're going to discuss this later. Accommodation can be stimulated when the patient is looking at a near object like refractive instruments or lenses, or can be there in a patient with hypermetropia if he's trying to overcome this hypermetropia, or if the patient is passing into accommodative spasm. We can stop accommodation by cycloplegics or fogging. Cycloplegics are used if there is accommodative spasm, if there is latent hyperopia, or if there is persistent symptoms after non-cycloplegic refraction. Keep in mind, cycloplegic may reduce or eliminate the in the range of 0.5 to 1.5 diopters. So this may result in blurred vision when normal accommodation is resumed. Again, cycloplegics will produce pupillary dilatation, so spherical abrasion through the periphery of the pupil may occur. Fogging, this is the eye under examination. We start to add plus power lenses, and as you can see, the more the plus power we add, the focus will be toward the myopic side. We're going to do this so that the vision will drop to 636. Now we are sure that the patient's eye is fogged, and we start to check the power we need to give. Once we reach to the point, then we start to defog, and gradually the focus will come back toward the retina and the vision will improve. Our aim is to use the highest plus lens or the least minus lens to reach the best visual acuity. Suppose we are correcting a patient with myopia. Sometimes, if we add more or minus lenses, the patient will accommodate for that by doing contraction of the ciliary muscle by doing accommodation. This will create a condition of reverse Galilean telescope. In such a condition, patient will see letters smaller and more distinct, being darker, and the patient may misinterpret this as clearer. Let me remind you of the Galilean telescope principle. It's a combination of plus lens and a minus lens with coinciding focal points. Rays will come out with larger angle subtended to the eye, so objects will appear enlarged. Reverse Galilean telescope causes letters to appear smaller, more distinct, and the patient may interpret this as clearer. Sometimes patients prefer a high contrast magnifying image while over accommodating. So you need to ask the patient if this is definitely better or the letters are just smaller and blacker. Don't agree with the patient's enthusiasm of adding more minus lenses that does not allow more letters to be read. Keep in mind that the endpoint is the highest plus lens or the least minus lens for the best visual acuity. Now we need to check for the astigmatism. We can do this using the astigmatic dial, which is covered in another presentation. Again, after reaching the expected spherical correction, we are doing still some fogging. We show the patient the astigmatic dial. We correct him with the cylinder till he see all the lines at the same degree. Then we start to remove the extra lenses. Again, we can use the opaque slit. We need to use it in cases of irregular astigmatism or in cases of lenticular or corneal opacity or in cases of a small pupil. In such cases, we cannot detect astigmatism nicely with the retinoscopy. So, with fogging, we start to apply the slit. We rotate it and asking the patient where is the sharpest image. For example, it will say it's at the 90 degrees. Then we can add more lenses till we get the best vision on this meridia. Then we rotate the slit 90 degrees and add more lenses till we get a clear image. Suppose this meridia we added two more. Now we know that the patient has a cylinder of plus two. Or we can use the cross cylinder, and also this is covered in another presentation. When the determined cylinder is reached, we start to unfog the patient by removing one quarter of the plus sphere at a time gradually till we reach to the highest plus or the least minus lens. Then we want to recheck that the sphere is at the proper endpoint by doing the diachrome test. Lastly, we need to check that we have a binocular balance to be sure that the accommodation is equally relaxed in both eyes. So we can check this by one of two things. Either we can do alternating occlusion or prism dissociation. How to do alternating occlusion? This is the expected correction with the sphere, cylinder, everything. Then we start to blur the patient. Now the vision is blurred, say to 6-12. Then we start to do alternating occlusion, and ask the patient, is the image equally blurred on each side? If not, then we're going to add plus sphere on the side with better vision till both sides are equally blurred. Once equally blurred both sides, we know that accommodation is relaxed to the same degree on both sides. This is the alternating occlusion. The second method is we can use what is known as prism dissociation. Now, after reaching the correction, we blur both sides to 612 or 615. Then we put a prism in front of one eye of a power 4 to 6 diopters prism, or we can divide the same amount on both eyes. Now, this side, the image will be shifted up, and this side, the image will be shifted down. Both sides should be blurred to the same degree. In this example, this eye shows better than the other one. Then I'm going to add more lenses so till both sides are blurred. Prism dissociation is the most sensitive test of binocular balance. Patient can identify as little as 1/4 of a sphere difference between the two eyes. So, to sum up, we make occlusion of one eye better to not to use occluder, but to use plus lens. We need to avoid any accommodation by cycloplegic or fogging. We check the sphere till we reach to the least minus or highest plus. We check the cylinder with different methods like the astigmatic fan. Then we recheck that we are not over correcting the patient with the duochrome test. And lastly, we check the binocular balance either by alternating occlusion or by prism dissociation. Thank you for your attention.